So we're getting our second take at the mid-engine 2020 Corvette. We drove it before, but we drove an $85,000 Z51 package, a lot like the one you see behind me that we're driving on the track today. But what I'm most excited about is we got to drive the $60,000 1LT, the base version, because we wanted to see, is it any good? And the short answer is, yes, yes it is. Chevrolet clearly has some ambitious supercar beating goals with this drastic change in layout. But does that mean the everyday base version's ride quality has been ruined? It's something the C6 and C7 generations have always done well, especially in base trim levels. And the answer is not at all. The ride quality is unbelievably refined. This car is as road trip ready as any base Vette before it. After driving on long stretches of highway, the C8's ride can best be described as serene. The increased chassis rigidity can be thanked, but so can the choice of tires. Now, what comes standard are Michelin all-season tires versus the C7's Michelin summer tires. Before you get all upset that all seasons come standard on a mid-engine supercar, know that straight line acceleration is barely affected with these 305 millimeter wide rear tires that held up extremely well during acceleration blast. Chevrolet says 0 to 60 for the base model with these all seasons is still 3.0 seconds versus 2.9 seconds of the Z51 package with the summer tires. A lot of what's helping traction is just having all of that weight around the rear tires. The weight distribution is 40 in the front and 60 in the rear, and you can really feel that as far as acceleration, where there's not a whole lot of wheel spin even with all-season tires on the street. What comes standard on every 2020 Corvette is the removable center section roof. Hardtop Corvette owners are familiar with this. It's been around for many generations, and it comes off in the same way as previous cars. So there are three latches, and then it stores in the back. The difference is when that roof is stored in the trunk, it takes up almost all usable area for larger items. We had to move two backpacks to the front trunk because there just wasn't any space for the roof back there. And the experience is overall like 70% of what you get from a convertible. There is a retractable hardtop convertible on its way, and what that gets you is a roof that goes down by its own instead of manually removing it. And then also a big part of the convertible with the Corvette is that with the top down, that cargo area behind the engine is unaffected. But it's great that every Vette does come with that removable roof. It's a really pleasant experience. Although if you do have longer hair, recommend bringing a hair tie with you, because that air, the way it's channeled through the car, feels like it hits you in the back of the head. So yes, the mechanics, the ride quality of the new Vette will support some great road tripping. And what's new is also that the interior is a nice place to be, especially if you want to spend a lot of time. The high-quality base model has a decent amount of soft-touch materials, and the metal drive controller and steering wheel have a sense of weight and quality that was missing from the C7. Vette owners no longer have to make excuses for the interior, because even in base models, you're getting a decent piece. And if you open your pocketbook, the interior can be covered in an assortment of high-quality materials, including Napa leather, genuine aluminum, carbon fiber, and suede microfiber. The larger problem with the interior is over-the-shoulder visibility and passenger accommodations. You know, nobody expected great visibility from a mid-engine car. None of them are really that good. What makes the car more livable are electronic assists like blind spot monitoring, rear cross traffic alert, and the rear-view camera mirror. The bummer, though, is that none of those are included on the $60,000 car, not even as optional. You have to step up to the 2LT trim level, which starts at $67,000. The passenger space is also odd. Being the driver in the Vette is great, with a driver-focused layout. All the controls and screens are within easy reach and view, and I love the view out the windshield and how the car wraps around you. On the passenger side, though, the tall center console ridge feels like a partition, and it's less inviting for passengers. I didn't really feel part of the experience when riding shotgun in the new Vette. back to what you do get standard for $60,000, and that's this engine and transmission combo, the 490 horsepower 6.2 liter V8 and the 8-speed dual clutch automatic transmission. Now, this dual clutch transmission is a world-class transmission that pairs perfectly with the meaty 6.2 liter, and that is astonishing at the $60,000 starting price. Diehard manual transmission fans, yes, there is no manual transmission, but if you like driving manual because of the directness and control that you had, know that the paddle shifters are extremely responsive, and it doesn't get much better than how fast these paddle shifters respond to inputs. Chevrolet says they've been able to get that responsiveness because the shifters are connected directly to the transmission control module rather than going through the rest of the vehicle control systems, which can create a lag. I prefer the directness of the manual mode on the street, but the automatic was the way to go on Z51 cars on the track, where the slightest throttle tip-in picks the perfect gear and rev match downshifts are smooth and well chosen. I felt no need to try and outsmart the clearly smarter than me calibration in the Z51's track mode. On the slower autocross though, I did prefer the manual mode because at slower speeds, you know, 0 to 50 versus 30 to 120 on the track, the transmission did want to upshift when I wanted it to hold a gear. Now, I was driving pre-production cars and did experience some low speed judder that, you know, could be tuned out when the production cars are rolling off the line, but it wasn't as frequent as what I've experienced in a BMW M3 M4 with the DCT, and is more on par with the Porsche PDK transmission. All of my street driving was done in that base model 1LT $61,000 car that only had optional wheels and an optional battery package. At the same event though, I was able to hop into a Z51, the performance package, that for $5,000 gets you a new suspension, summer tires, additional cooling, electronically controlled limited slip diff, more downforce, and this standard performance exhaust that bumps up horsepower to 495. Now, tracking the Z51 really only whetted my appetite for the more aggressive versions that will surely come down the line. You know, I didn't get fully familiar with the car after only a half dozen so or laps, but my initial reaction is that I just had to be more gingerly than I expected, using trail braking to help the front end turn versus just wheeling into a corner that you could with, you know, some of the special editions of other Vettes like the Grand Sport or even on the Camaro 1LE. What was most impressive about driving the C8 on the track was really just how quickly it darts from corner to corner. It feels light on its feet and highly responsive. Back to the $60,000 car, should you buy the $60,000 C8? The lack of visibility aids is my one hesitation from recommending a truly base model car, because visibility is so poor. I relied on my passenger to scout out lane changes for me, and driving in the city was a really high-strung experience. You know, blind spot, rear cross-traffic alert, and the rearview mirror camera help for sure. But you can only get those on the 2LT. Now the 2LT is also going to give you heated and cooled seats, a heated steering wheel, as well as the performance data recorder for recording video, especially when you're on the track. And you also get a head-up display and upgraded stereo. Now that 2LT costs $67,000, and you gotta buy the $1,200 optional performance exhaust. You know, the V8 is really what makes the Corvette a Corvette, and you want to hear it. The stock exhaust is just a little too quiet by the loud pipes. And even at $68,000, $69,000, here's the thing, that still feels like a bargain.